And it's now my great pleasure to introduce our speakers today. We are very lucky to be joined by Dr. Chantale Lussier. She's a proven game changer in mental health literacy, mental skills training, and optimal mental performance. Dr. Lussier is the founder and CEO of Elysian Insights, a company dedicated to mental performance solutions. Now, you're going to find out a little bit more about who Chantale is when Sharon does a full introduction. And our other speaker today, our other expert, Kami's going to introduce.
Yeah, NWT's very own Dr. Sharon Ann Firth. She is the first Gwich'in Indigenous woman to compete in 4 Winter Olympics. She has an astounding list of awards and accomplishments under her belt, which will be introduced shortly as well. So at this point, we are extremely excited for what's in store today. And Chantale, I will pass it over to you.
Okay, so today's presentation, of course, is entitled Your High Performer 2, Mental Performance Considerations for Leaders in Sport. And of course, I'd like to begin by acknowledging and thanking our sports partners, CIRC, as well as Sport North, as well as our special guest, Sharon, who is joining us today, and each and every one of you. I know schedules are busy these days, and it means a lot that you would protect an hour to be with us to talk about an important topic. Of course, mental health. And of course, let's acknowledge we're doing that as everyone across Canada is actually celebrating and thinking about mental performance mental health awareness this week across all of Canada. So what a timely gathering we are having. So to tell you very briefly the agenda, what you can expect in this hour, we're going to have a bit more of an introduction real quick so you know who is here today. We're going to talk about mental health from the perspective of you being a high performer. You know, as coaches, we tend to be so athlete oriented and on so many levels, that's a really important thing. But sometimes we forget that we too, as coaches and as leaders, we're high performers as well. We're trying to juggle a lot of different things. And what does mental health mean in our own lives? So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about mental health across Canada within the COVID context, of course. We're going to talk about why this matters to you as coaches. We're going to also address the mental health continuum model and how that might be a useful tool to have in your coach's toolbox. And then part two, we're really going to talk about the fact that mental health is not just something we experience personally, but is really something that is shared. It's part of our social experience. And of course, it's directly involved in your experiences of how you serve as a coach and as a leader. And then of course, we're going to make sure we protect a good 15 to 20 minutes at the end for a Q&A so that you can pick my brain, Sharon's brain, and so that we can have hopefully a really meaningful sharing circle together and get to hear from you a little bit as well. So that's the plan for today. And you've already heard a little bit about Sharon, but it's my pleasure to continue her introduction. As Kami said, Dr. Sharon Firth is a 4-time Olympian in cross-country skiing. She participated and competed in the Winter Olympics in 1972, 76, 1980, and 84. Her mother was Gwinnett and her father was Métis, and she and her sister grew up in the Gwinnett First Nations community. Her and her sister Shirley competed from 1968 to 1985 and were both members of Canada's national cross-country team. They were the first female Indigenous athletes to represent Canada on the international stage, including at 4 Winter Olympics. And together, the sisters obtained a total of 79 medals at various national championships, which is no small amount, is it? It's important to mention they became the first Indigenous women to be inducted in Canada's Sports Hall of Fame in 2015. And of course, Sharon has accumulated an incredible amount of honors, and I'd like to mention a few of them here, including the John Semolik Memorial Award, the Commissioner's Award, the Order of Canada Award, the Queen's Golden Jubilee Medal, the Canadian Ski Museum and Skiing Hall of Fame, the National Aboriginal Achievement Award. She also received an honorary doctorate in law from the University of Alberta, and most recently was brought into the Order of the Northwest Territories in 2018. So needless to say, Sharon, it's a pleasure to have you on the call. It's a real honor to have you join us today.
Thank you, Chantale. That was very awesome. I get so excited when I'm introduced with all those awards, because it wasn't an easy accomplishment. It was all, you know, bestowed upon us by the people of the Northwest Territory. So I honor them greatly for believing in Shirley and I. So to introduce yourself, Ben Guinzi, to everyone that's out there, it's I'm really excited to be part of this project here, and hope you can all ask me as many questions you need to know, because as a high performance, athlete performing at the highest level at the Olympics and promoting Indigenous people across the world and also the Northwest Territory. So introducing Dr. Chantale Lussier, when I first heard that I was going to be presenting with her, I Googled her right away because I wanted to know, who is this amazing woman? And did not disappoint. So Dr. Chantale Lussier has a PhD in mental performance coach and founder and CEO of Elysian Insight Mental Performance Solutions, a highly sought after specialist in her field and professional member for the Canadian Sports Psychology Association and the Association for Applied Sports Psychology. Chantale has worked with thousands of nationally and internationally ranked competitive elite and pro athletes, NFL, CFL, NHL dancers, performing arts, and executives. So pleasure introducing you, Chantale.
Thank you so much. It's a real pleasure to get to share this conversation with you, Sharon, and I'm so grateful for that very special introduction. Thank you. And so I'm going to now get into the first part of our presentation, which is, of course, the idea that you as a coach, you're a high performer too. Yes, you get to coach these wonderful athletes and contribute meaningfully to their development and their ultimate competitive experience, but you yourself as a coach are also performing under pressure, and I have no doubt are also challenging yourself to be your own best every single day when you show up in various capacities in your life. So to present a little bit of context, obviously right now we're, mental health is always important, but we're now at over a year across Canada experiencing this current pandemic. And we know that this has not only had an effect on many, many different parts of everyday life and on our physical well-being, we also know that during various kinds of pandemics, the number of people whose mental health is affected actually tends to be greater than the number of people who are affected by the infection itself. What we know historically from past tragedies of past epidemics is we know that the mental health implications can also last longer and have a greater prevalence than the pandemic itself. So while there is light at the end of the tunnel, and we know we've been resilient for a long time and we're getting through this, we need to be mindful that there has been an impact on our mental well-being and on our psychosocial and economic impact as well. And so how we take care of ourselves, including our mental health, is going to be really significant to getting through this pandemic individually and collectively in a way that's really sustainable. And so, if I was to go around the table or around currently our little screen on Zoom, and if I was to ask everybody, in your team, in your organization, in your context of coaching, do you have someone who's there hired full time to be responsible for the mental health and well-being of your team and your athletes? If I had to guess, I would suspect the answer is no. The reality is that for sport across Canada, almost at all levels, except perhaps at the national team level, most teams do not have access to mental health experts. And so the reality is that means a lot of the responsibility can feel like it's falling on your shoulders as coaches, because of course you get to see your athletes going through their ups and downs. Knowing what your scope of practice is really important, but helping you feel empowered, feeling like you know how to take great care of your own self so that you can feel like you can lead by example is really significant. In case you've had moments where maybe you've worried that you're the only one who's been feeling that way, I wanted to share just very briefly some research that is currently being conducted by the Canadian Commission of Mental Health. And it's a research study that's being done in partnership with the University of British Columbia and other research partners. And they've been doing three waves of data collection across Canada. Although I have to say, I was highly disappointed, and I need to point it out, that while it's been across Canada in the southern area, unfortunately, there isn't any data, to my knowledge, that's being collected currently in the Northwest Territories. So that's highly unfortunate. But I thought I would share this piece of data in case it feels significant right now to know that we're not the only ones who sometimes feel overwhelmed. In fact, across the southern parts of Canada, over 40% of people would say that their mental health has declined to various degrees since the onset of the pandemic. And if we look a little bit more at what are people experiencing, what's the emotional response that people have in the COVID-19 context, what we can see is almost 50% have said that they're experiencing more anxiety or just more worry. And it's not surprising, right? We're dealing with a lot of uncertainty, and we've had to, you know, adjust and pivot a lot as things get shut down, reopen, or as our day-to-day way of living has had to be modified temporarily. People have also said that they feel more stressed, up to 38%. And at least a quarter of us have experienced a lot more sadness or depression. And I think it's really interesting that they also asked on the flip side of things, you know, how many people feel relatively calm in the face of COVID? Now, keep in mind, this data was collected during the second wave, which was last September. And at that point, only about a fifth of Canadians said that they felt calm, right? And we're now many months later. So when we talk about things like hopefulness, empathic, or content, you probably have noticed your own emotional curve throughout this pandemic experience. You probably have had moments where your mental health was resilience and bouncing back, and we're going to get through it. And you might have had some days or weeks where it started to feel more heavy and more challenging, right? So I wanted to share that so that we remember we are not alone in this. And as we remember mental health this week across Canada, let's remember that we are in this together. Now, I had the pleasure of listening to a great panel a little while ago that was hosted by She's for Sport and Canadian Women in Sport. And one of the panelists, Maria Montejo, brought a really wonderful perspective, because a lot of times in my experience with mental health, we tend to take a very intrapersonal, very individualistic lens on it. And the reality, of course, is that we as humans actually live in a collective. And what Maria said on the panel, she said from an Indigenous perspective, she said, you see the human being as a whole person. And furthermore, she said, you can't separate athlete and human. And I'm going to add here, you also can't separate coach from human. In fact, we are whole all the time, no matter how we try to compartmentalize. And so she suggests that our wellness is actually our fundamental state of who we are. And our practices, our daily habits, are what we do to try to sustain that well-being as we navigate the experience of being human. And I put this image here to remind us that there are many facets when we consider wellness, including mental health, from a holistic standpoint. And some things you may or may not have thought about is how, for example, spirituality may help support your mental health, or how, for example, nature and the environment might be a significant component to your well-being. I know I've got to get some contact time with nature every day to be at my best. And then, of course, social wellness, which looks different in a pandemic, of course, with all the social distancing and all that. But how can we make sure we still feel meaningfully connected so that we can actually support our mental health? And so why does this matter? Well, some researchers are saying that, especially in a pandemic, in a time where fear and uncertainty is quite high, and when threats to our own survival are there, and that of others becomes the main issue of daily life, mental health care sometimes, unfortunately, can kind of be put to the side, like it doesn't matter. And in fact, we need to remember that mental health is precisely one of the things that's going to allow us not just to survive through the pandemic, but to actually ultimately be resilient and thrive, not only in the short term, but also in the long term. And so when we talk about mental health, what do we mean? There's so many different potential definitions. And I found that this one by Breslin and colleagues really captured it quite well. They say mental health is defined as a state of well-being in which individuals can actually realize their own potential, can cope with the normal stressors of life, can work productively and fruitfully, and are able to make contributions to his or her community. Now, as people in sport, as committed coaches and leaders in sport, I have no doubt that you want to be able to help your athletes be at their own potential. And as we heard even at the beginning, many of you want to keep growing and becoming better coaches yourself, right? So we know we want to be able to be productive and to contribute meaningfully to our community. And so our own mental health is really vital to allow us to do that in ways that are sustainable so that we don't burn out. And so these researchers, they go on and they actually suggest that coaches, because of your role in the community and being athlete facing, might actually be better equipped to prevent or deal with athlete stresses more effectively. And this is why coach training in mental health awareness and mental health literacy is so important, because you get to play a vital role in the emotional climate of the daily training environment and the performance environment. And we know that if we create that great environment, that's going to help to enhance positive interactions, and that's going to help to enhance really great relationships between you and your athletes. And I know you're on this workshop today because that matters to you a lot. And so this is why I wanted to present relatively quickly, but hopefully meaningfully, this tool. There are many different mental health models out there. I have two that are my favorites, and this is one of them. This is called the Mental Health Continuum Model. And to give you a little bit of context, the source of this, by the way, is the Mental Health Commission of Canada. And this has been utilized by a lot of different government organizations. It's been brought into to help men and women in the military forces with all kinds of sectors across government and across the business sector. And it's now slowly but surely being taught in more environments in terms of the Canadian public. Now, one of the things I love about the mental health continuum model, as you can see, is that it's very visual. We get a spectrum that acknowledges that mental health is not static. It's constantly, fluidly adapting. And it's saying sometimes we're in the green, you know, green light is go, right? If we're driving, kind of said the same thing with mental health. Green here says that we're feeling healthy in terms of our mental well-being. We're experiencing relatively normal mood fluctuations. We're sleeping with healthy patterns. Our energy physically is pretty great. We're feeling, you know, that sense of aliveness and vitality. We're feeling relatively social, and we're able to perform perhaps as coaches and in all of the other areas of your life in ways that are relatively consistent, right? But as we acknowledged at the beginning, 50% of you are feeling that your mental health is pretty strained, and 40% are feeling, okay, I'm coping, but I'm being asked to be resilient. And this is where you might identify with the yellow, the orange, or maybe even some days with the red. And you can see at the top of the graph here how, for example, in reacting, what you might notice in yourself or that you might notice with your athletes could be a little bit more nervousness or irritability or sadness. You could realize that your sleep patterns are changing. Maybe they're disturbed, or maybe it's actually unable to fall asleep, right? You might notice in your body that you're more fatigued, more tired, that maybe you get tension headaches. Maybe your muscles aren't recovering the same way they used to. You might all of a sudden notice in yourself or again in your athletes that there's more procrastination, and you don't mean to, or they don't mean to, but it's just happening a bit more. Or maybe there's more absences that are unexplained. And there's a little bit of a withdrawing that can happen, right? So to me, this is where the mental health continuum model becomes almost like a great compass that we can carry in our back pocket and kind of check in with ourselves, maybe a few times a week. How am I doing? Right? Or it can even become a reference point that you use with your athletes. How would you describe your mental health today? What color would you identify? And without even needing to have a huge conversation, it's a way to just acknowledge we're a whole human. Mental health is part of how we're doing. And it allows us to potentially open up the lines of dialogue. And now at the bottom of the mental health continuum, you can also see that there are actions you can take. If all of a sudden you're feeling like your mental health is more compromised, maybe it's about recognizing our limits. Maybe it's about identifying what our triggers are. Maybe it's about actually seeking to talk to someone, right? And as a coach, maybe that means speaking to a peer coach or a trusted friend or a trusted mentor in your community. And I find a lot of times, especially as leaders in sport, we know so many people look to us for leadership. We sometimes forget that we can also seek support too, right? And so I want to take this moment to say, it's okay for you as a coach to sometimes reach out and say, hey, can we make time to talk? I could really use a little support right now. Right? Because we're going to do that for our athletes. We're going to do that for their families, but let's make sure we do that for ourselves and for each other as well. So the mental health continuum model there has some great strategies so that when we're in the yellow or the orange, we can start taking some positive actions to support our mental health. So needless to say, there are many different things that could compromise our mental health on any given day. And there are many different ways that we could also be resilient, right? And so I would invite you to think about what are some of the things either in your past or in your present personal life that may have caused your mental health to be compromised, right? Many of us have gone through really challenging traumas, or perhaps are going through them now. Many of us have experienced grief and bereavement or relationship changes or even relocation and moving. Some of us may have experienced illness or injury and a big recovery period, or perhaps changes or uncertainty or job loss that all of a sudden brings about some stresses around finances and other realities of daily life. And then, of course, if we think of our coaching reality and our various professional responsibilities, there could be some things in our work life that also is compromising our mental health and mental performance sometimes. Maybe there's some weeks where we work really long hours, or as we said at the beginning, where we juggle multiple roles. I know right now in the COVID environment, most of us are staying put at home. But outside of the COVID environment, in sport, we tend to travel a lot. And while that's a lot of fun in many ways, sometimes that can be really, really tiring, including to our mental health. Sometimes it's interpersonal conflicts or dynamics on certain teams or organizations that are quite toxic, that can cause some real challenges to our mental well-being. Or there can be all kinds of career obstacles, or even, I call them professional injuries, that sooner or later, some of us might experience, right? Whether it's an obstacle to our career growth through discrimination or sexism or things like that, or whether all of a sudden a contract ends. In sport, a lot of times things are contract oriented, and we don't know from contract to contract when that next opportunity is going to come. And there's a lot of changes and turnovers in sports. So sometimes that can cause a lot of a sense of unstableness or uneasiness, which sometimes can stress our mental well-being. And so the second part, which I'll try to go through relatively quickly because I want us to make sure we keep our conversation going together, but is the piece that I feel is not often talked about when it comes to mental health. And it's the idea that mental health is actually a social experience. Yes, we all have so much going on that's very private and very personal, but it's also something we experience together, right? If one person is struggling, it's going to impact the other person, and vice versa, one person has the opportunity to help another person. So You know, the World Health Organization talks about the fact that good mental health is actually integral to human health and well-being, and that a person's mental health, including when we're struggling with mental disorders or mental unwellness, is actually shaped by social factors, economic factors, and our physical environment. Our mental health is influenced by many things, including life experiences, workplace and other environments, and the social and economic conditions that ultimately shape our lives. And so I just want to take this moment to acknowledge that the social determinants of health can actually be more important and more impactful than even our healthcare or personal lifestyle choices. And so, for example, the Canadian Mental Health Association talks about what are some of the social determinants of health? And that includes our cultural heritage, how we identify, which could include Aboriginal status or disability status. It could include some of our early life experiences, whether they were positive or really, really challenging, including intergenerational circumstances. It could include our experiences through education and our experiences under different kinds of employment or working conditions. And as we just started to talk about, even some very fundamental things like food security or insecurity. And do we have a safe roof over our heads? What are the access to our health services? And countless other things, including gender identity, housing, income, race, sexual orientation, and whether we feel social inclusion, whether we feel like there's a social safety net, or whether we feel like there's some kind of security in the workplace. So all those things, let's acknowledge, are going to impact our own mental well-being as well as the mental well-being of the athletes we work with. And so let me just go through this a little bit quickly so I leave more time for other things. But basically, I think one of the things that's important to recognize in sport is that sometimes we're going to realize that at a systems level, there's some inequalities or there's some barriers to care with mental health. And let's make sure that in each of our pockets, in each of our social sporting experiences, that we try to identify where the opportunities to enhance mental health, to enhance access to care, and where perhaps are some of those systemic obstacles that we can try to work together to eliminate and to certainly improve so that mental health is improved. As I briefly alluded to before, certainly the context of safe sport in Canada is something that's been part of the Canadian conversation now, I would say in the last few years, and certainly has been timely and I would even say long overdue. And when we talk about safe sport and what it means to have a psychological safe environment in sport, not only is that vital for the well-being of our athletes, but it's vital for all of us, right? We have to make sure that it's psychologically safe for you as coaches to show up and be great coaches, and that for all of the leaders and administrators in sport as well. And so I would invite us to reflect, you know, the different environments that you get to be a part of. Are they safe and healthy? Are they inclusive? Are they optimal and sustainable? Are we together and individually practicing bringing a non-judgmental lens to ourselves and to each other? And of course, are we being kind to ourselves and to each other, right? Because a lot of times when our mental well-being is strained, all of a sudden, certain things in the environment are also impacted and vice versa, right? So let's recognize that that team cohesion and the psychological safety allows us to feel like we belong in our context of work, in our context of sport, and of course, in our communities. And so some researchers are suggesting that coaches and leaders in sport have the potential to support athlete mental well-being. But as we heard at the start of this conversation, many of us are unsure what to do or even how to make sure that we don't unintentionally bring harm instead of goodness, right? And so this is where ongoing education and preventative behaviors become really important. And so I know you're already becoming more and more aware of this if you weren't before. But obviously, coaches, you have such incredible proficiencies, you know, in the X's and O's or in the technical abilities in your sport. But more than ever, I know that you know you're being called to sometimes be mindful of your athlete's own mental well-being and what impact is that having on yours. So very quickly, I'm putting up this little list. It's not exhaustive at all. It's a few suggestions for you. Some of these things are things that I do or things Sharon and I have talked about as well that help to support our mental well-being or well-being practices in general. So I put them under three categories. One of them is what I would call self-regulation techniques, things that allow us either to energize ourselves when we need to, or things that allow us to relax ourselves, both in body and in mind. So think about those daily habits that allow you to do that, to either activate or to relax, right? So something as simple as a daily walk sometimes can kind of invigorate us a little bit. And other times, a daily walk at the end of the day might actually be something that's relaxing. Maybe for some of you, it's a practice of prayer or meditation or some other kind of mental or spiritual practice like that. It could be something as simple and yet as profound as breath work, making sure that you pause a few moments every single day to connect your mind, your spirit, and your body in this one moment with maybe just one or two simple deep breaths. Or it could be something such as progressive muscle relaxation. And that's an example that if you're curious, you could literally Google that and get all kinds of examples of a guided meditation that allows you to work through tension and relaxation from head to toe in a way that's really great, not only to relax the body, but also to relax your mind. Then, of course, we could talk about strategies around the great outdoors, right? Making sure that we get enough natural light, which in Canada, and depending on the weather and which part we live in, might mean we have to really pay attention to that. How do I try to design my day to at least get a little bit of a natural light, right? For me, for example, I try to make sure I chase as many sunsets and sunrises as possible. My work day and my daily life doesn't allow me to do it every single day, but it's something that I love to do. It's good for my body and it's good for my mind. And even some of the sounds of nature. I know, for example, that the beautiful songs of birds is something that it brings me so much joy and so much peacefulness. I know it's good for my mental well-being. And then the third category I put under the idea of witnessing our own minds, right? Witnessing our own thoughts. And Sharon brought up the great idea of journaling and inviting our athletes to journal. And maybe it's journaling as part of their day-to-day training practices. And maybe it's also as part of their mental health practices. What are their thoughts? What are their feelings? What are your thoughts? What are your feelings? And perhaps you have other rituals or even different artistic expressions that allow you to not only enjoy those things intrinsically, but that you know when you do these things, your mental well-being actually benefits. I know for me, dance and music is a big part of my life. And I know these days I need to do and incorporate a lot more of that. So I'd like to ask you, you know, to reflect who's on your team, who's part of your community, where can you turn to when you as a coach need support? And likewise, you know, what are the things that fill up your cup when you need to take great care of yourself? What are some of the things that allow you to take care of your mental well-being? What are some of your self-care strategies? And it'd be wonderful to hear some of your strategies. What's worked for you so far? And perhaps, you know, what do you feel we need to, like, where to from here as a community? So I turn the mic over to all of you. And on that note, of course, I'd like to say a huge thank you to Sport Nord, to Cirque, of course, to my co-presenter, Sharon, and to each and every one of you for joining us today. It's been a real honor and a pleasure to see you all and to share in this conversation.